Hey everybody, what's up? This is Devin Lavore and
Michelle Lavore
coming at you with a little Q&A
Friday.
And we didn't do it last Friday, as you know, because we didn't have the internet, but we're going to tackle some of these questions. And the first question comes from Nicole Horn that she asked during our first Q&A.
Yeah.
So this is almost like 2 weeks old. So sorry, Nicole. But here we go.
Yeah.
And she asked the question of, like, when Jesus was on the cross, why did he say, you know, my God, why have you forsaken me? And if you read Psalm 22, it actually says that. It reads that, my God, why have you forsaken me? And, you know, it's a pretty popular and well-known messianic prophecy that the Messiah would say that, or it would be connected
to
him somehow.
Yeah, well, and really all of Psalm 22 is very much about everything that Jesus
even
went through.
Even the details of his crucifixion. Mm-hmm. Isn't that where they talk about they divide my clothing and
I'm pretty sure,
stuff? But we'd have to get into it. But
But
basically, Jesus was human. See, a human messed things up. So it took a human to restore things.
Mm-hmm.
And God was like, but I'm the only one who can restore it. So what am I going to do? Well, I already know what I'm going to do because I knew this was going to happen. So Jesus became human. The Word of God made flesh, was made flesh and dwelt among us.
Mm-hmm.
The Word itself, the promise in human form, came to fulfill the promise.
Yeah.
Oh, that's amazing. So being human, it's like Jesus was born of the Spirit. But now so are we born of the Spirit. He walked by the Spirit, so we walk by the Spirit. But you know what the truth of the matter is? Even though he was the Word in the flesh, he walked and he prophesied in part and he knew in part. He only did what he saw the Father do.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And you can get lost in the theological weeds with this question, but the bottom line is he was human.
Yeah.
He became human. So he didn't know everything. He wasn't existing everywhere at all, but with like omniscient and omnipresent and all. He wasn't that.
Mm-hmm.
He became human. And so when he died on the cross and he felt the weight of the sin,
mm-hmm.
he felt that separation from God as well. He felt the separation from the Father as well. And he was just like, and he was probably hanging up there for hours expecting that, okay, I was just kind of thinking I would be killed and then we would be done. I'm not expecting to hang up here for 6 hours, you know? So that's probably where that came from, the my God,
well, and I just think even it was just his heart was just in deep grief and pain because he bore this all of our sins on himself. And like you said, being separated from God, I mean, the grief in that. And so I think that it was
something he never felt in his life, an
expression of his heart was just like, my God, why have you forsaken me? Because that is what he was just feeling, the intensity of what he was feeling at that time.
Yeah, I agree. So, Nicole, we hope that helps. And anyone else out there that might have had that question. And so the next question we got was a very simple question, and it was, how do you do it? And that was in reference to us taking this step of faith to come to Nashville with no permanent residence in sight, just based on like what we believe God asked us to do. And there's six of us. There's two of us and four kids, one baby. You know, one of them is only 7 months old.
Mm-hmm.
He's sleeping over there. Praise the Lord. High five. Mm-hmm. Anyway, it's like, how do you do it? Well, the bottom line is, we live by faith. We took a step of faith, and now we're continuing to take steps of faith. It's called walking.
Yeah.
And we're walking by faith.
Yeah.
And it is not easy. It is not easy on so many levels. A lot of times you think it's about the money. The money's not easy. That is a challenge, but God provides for that as well. But it's like there's other things that go on in the soul and the heart, dealing with other people and how they don't understand why we're doing what we're doing and how that affects us. It's just, it's difficult. And it's like without God, we just couldn't do it.
Yeah.
If this wasn't the Lord, we would have been done already.
Yeah.
The first time we came, we lasted a week. But that was the Lord. He was like, you're going to last about a week, and then I want you to come back. We're going to regroup.
Yeah. But it really is just, God gives you grace to do what it is that you need to do.
Yeah.
You know, and so really that's what we've been walking with as well, is just the grace of God. And so, you know, yeah, it can be difficult, but we can overcome because God's walking through it with us. Mm-hmm. You know, if this was not what he wanted us to do, we wouldn't be able to do that, you know. And
no one can do this.
Yeah.
I think without the Lord, you can't.
Mm-hmm.
You can't just step out of there, step out of basically Kansas City with a certain amount of money. That certain amount of money is long gone.
Yeah.
And it's just like you have to, and it's like when you guys give to us, it's like you just have no idea how blown away we are.
Yeah.
Just like, because it's like what Paul said to the churches. Paul gave praise to God for what God put on their heart
mm-hmm.
to do. To give for the things that he was doing and the things that he was facilitating and what everything that God had called Paul to do, he needed help to do it. Yes, he worked with his hands and he was a tent maker, but he couldn't do everything that he was doing off of a tent maker's salary. He couldn't, mm-hmm. you know? And so it was like, well, we need help for this church and we need help for this thing. And so it's like, that's kind of like the position we're in right now.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of like when I went to YWAM. Like everybody that goes to YWAM or everyone that goes to IHOP and things like that, you feel like God's called you to do a thing. God calls you to do something that is beyond your ability.
Yeah.
So that he can prove to you his ability.
Exactly.
And that's just the bottom line, because if you can do it without God, then you probably will.
Yeah.
I mean, welcome to the United States of America.
Yeah.
You know? I'm just saying, like, this is the king of I can do it. Mm-hmm. I will arise. I will ascend.
Mm-hmm.
And then we wonder why the devil is just running rampant all over the mm-hmm. country. Because that's the same spirit of the enemy. The spirit of the devil from the very beginning was, I will ascend. I will go up to the mountain. I will be God. It was the same. We see it in Nimrod. And he had that same, I'm going to do it. And it's like, you can't do this without the Lord. You can't do anything of the Lord without the Lord.
Yeah.
That's what's so great, because he wants to do it, but he wants to invite you. He's like, I want to bake a cake. But I know my daughter, she loves to bake it. Here, come bake a cake with me.
Mm-hmm.
And basically, you bought the ingredients, you've done everything. And then she's going to help you crack the eggs, but you got to help her do it, and then you got to help her stir it, and you got to help. And it's like, oh, look, Dad, I baked a cake for you. Oh, you did awesome. You know what I mean? It's like, you did the whole thing.
Yeah.
So it's like, how do we do it?
By
faith.
Yeah, by faith. Just walking by faith and
trusting in God.
And, you know, like we said, it's not always easy, but, you know, when you have God, you can overcome everything.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah.
So one of our other questions that we got.
From Lauren B.
Yes, which is really more directed to Devin, but.
It's a Devin Q&A day.
Apparently is. but it was talking about how were you able to wait as long as you did to get married, and how did you handle just the discouragement and even, you know, having people come at you saying like, hey, just, you know, be content in your singleness and all of that. I know it's a loaded question.
No, that whole be content in your singleness thing.
Yeah.
Well, I would say if waiting to be married, like if you got like periodic progress reports and report cards, I pretty much got Fs most of the time because I did not like waiting. It was hard because I wanted to be married when I was 17
mm-hmm.
from that day forward. And I didn't get to know the Lord until I was 22 and a half. I didn't come to be saved and know Jesus. Yeah, I know Jesus. What do you mean? All this is real, and have my salvation experience and encounter moment with the Lord. Like, whoa, I didn't know any of this. From that day forward, it never changed.
Yeah.
I wanted to be married even more so then, because I was like, oh, I have God. He can do anything. God, get me married by the time I'm 25. He got you married by the time you were 25.
Yep.
But didn't get me married till I was 36, which was according to a prophetic word that he gave me when I was on a mission trip once. He's like, you're not getting married till you're 26. And I was like, what?
36.
I was like, no. Huh?
You said 26.
Oh, 36. Thank you. Hey, you got to say something.
I did.
So, But I did. I did terrible. Oh, I did so terrible a lot of the times. A lot of times I did try to wait and I tried to, but man, that longing was eating me alive. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was just, because I didn't like being alone. I wanted to be, you know, I was just like, Lord, you said it was not good for man to be alone. This is not good. You know, and I went through a lot of that. But ultimately, like, God got me through it, you know. Now, Michelle had a great idea, and she said, like, sometimes you can, what were you saying? You can, like, do things to, like, keep yourself busy.
Yeah, I think sometimes, you know, I think it can be one of those things where, you know, if you get focused on something in front of you, it's constantly in front of you. And so, you know, if it's...
It's the watching, the watch pot never boils thing, for sure.
And so it can be very good to... Maybe turn your attention to the places where other interests, other passions,
other people, you know.
You know, that doesn't mean that you have to just leave that alone, but sometimes...
Leave that alone.
What's I mean,
that?
Just...
Oh, that, your desire.
The desire and things like that.
Because that's never going to leave until it gets satisfied.
Yeah. But I think it's, you know, you can do things to help you... not focus on it. And I think that's where, you know, if you are by yourself and, you know, you can have nights that are lonely, it could be good to, just create maybe an environment where you're able to, you know, have friends and things be a part of your life. Because I think for me personally, like during the time when I was single, I was also very, very busy. It doesn't mean that I didn't ever experience loneliness, but there was, you know, things that I was involved in. And so there wasn't a lot of time just sitting and being like, oh, I'm so, so desperate. So I think that can help. Mm-hmm. When you are single and you're just feeling all of those emotions, it can help just to get your eyes off of it.
Yeah, but I think the thing that you have to do is, like, because I know that maybe there's some people out there that are doing all that, but they're still feeling it. And I think what you need to know is that that's normal.
Yeah.
You can be content to be single, but still be longing to be married. A lot of the times those fit in the same body.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and you're just waiting. Like us being here in Nashville. Yeah. We're content to live this life day in and day out, what God has for us to do. But yet there's a longing in us for a home. It's the same thing. It's not a sin to long or desire, obviously. But it's going to be hard. It can be hard sometimes, but you can weather the hardship by just going to God and just pouring out your heart to God. You know?
And I think being thankful is a way to combat against discontentment.
Yeah.
You know, being thankful for what God is doing in your life and, you know, because this really applies to more than just being single. It can apply to anything that you desire and that you're not getting.
Yeah.
And how do you live in a place...
How do you wait for it?
Yeah, how do you wait for it and wait in a place of peace?
You got to be thankful and just, oh, God, I thank you. You got to really right yourself.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So.
Yeah. So I think that's important.
Yeah, so our battery pack is getting ready to die.
Yeah. And
if it's not children, it's the battery.
But yeah, so that's what we have for you guys this week, and we would love to have more questions.
Yes, we love
anything
more questions
that you want to ask us about.
Or if you like, I want a part two to this question, please.
Yeah.
Like, okay, fine.
And so please put those down in the comments below.
And we appreciate the support, guys. We love you guys. The comments, the prayers, all of it. Awesome. You guys are a blessing to our life. And because some of you have given us gifts lately, and I can't email you.
Yeah.
For some reason. So we just wanted to say thank you to everybody.
Yes. So. We just so appreciate that. So until next time, guys, we'll see you later.
Bye.
Bye.